فصل في الحث على طلب العلم والعمل والتعليم، واطلب علوم الدين، وارقى إلى اليقين، فالعلم قوت القلب،
الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، نوينا التعلم والتعليم والتذكر والتذكير والنفع والانتفاع والإفادة والاستفادة والحث على التمسك بكتاب الله وبسنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، والدعاء إلى الهدى والدلالة على الخير، ابتغاء وجه الله ومرضاته وقربه وثوابه سبحانه مع لطف العافية برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم إنا نسألك العلم اللدني والمشرب الصافي الهني يا وهاب يا غني، وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم. So in this lesson, inshallah, we'll be going over the 5th, 6th, and 7th intervals of prayer, which are in Arabic الركوع, الاعتدال, and السجود, which are bowing, standing straight, and prostrating. And each one of those actions has its own conditions, which must be fulfilled properly for the interval to be correct. So we'll start with what the author says. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. الخامس الركوع وأقله أن ينحني حتى تنال راحته ركبتيه. Which in English means, and fifth, the bowing, and its minimum is to bend until both palms of the hands can reach both knees. So the word ruku' in Arabic linguistically means to bow down. And the reason its conditions is for both palms to reach the knees is because that is the only way that this action happens. So it's not necessary for the fingers to reach the knees, but just the palms. As long as the palms or a part of the palms reach the knees during the bowing, then it's been done correctly. So one of the things that the fuqaha warn about is not being in a position called inkhinas. Inkhinas is a position in which a person lowers their bottom and bends their knees, but their chest is forward. It's almost like the position that you see American football players stand in. It's almost like a squat. That position in Arabic is called inkhinas. Even though in the position of inkhinas, the palms reach the knees, it does not suffice because that is not called ruku'ah. So in any time someone gets in that position, it's invalid and they have to correct their position. Also, they said that proper bowing does not happen correctly if someone had exceptionally long arms, such that their palms could reach their knees without them having to bend over much. That is also not considered proper ruku'ah. For ruku'ah to happen properly, even if someone had very long arms, they must bend their back completely. Also, it's a condition to not have any doubts about doing the ruku'ah. So if someone is in the position of ruku' and they do not have the tam'anina, or they're not sure whether they have the tam'anina, which we'll get to in the second point, then the bowing is incorrect. Or if they're not sure whether they did it correctly or not, then also their bowing is incorrect. And the second point, the author says, وَيُشْتَرَطُ أَنْ يَطْمَئِنْ بِحَيْثُ تَسْتَقِرُ أَعْضَاؤُهُ وَأَنْ لَا يَقْصُدْ بِهِ غَيْرُهُ. Meaning, and it is required for one to have a momentary pause at which the whole body is stationary and not to intend to bow for any other reason. So you'll see throughout the intervals of prayer, it's always mentioned that after almost after every integral to have a tum'anina, which is from the famous hadith in which one of the companions, radiallahu anhum, went to the mosque to pray, but then he was doing it in such a quick speed that the Prophet ﷺ stopped him after he had prayed to correct him and told him that after every moment, there should be a moment of tum'anina, which is basically it's pausing for a moment of assurance to be sure that you did this act correctly. So, and the fuqaha say it should be about that same time span as reciting, as uttering the phrase Subhanallah. That is the minimum. And the pause should be long enough to distinguish that you are moving from an act to another act. So if someone just goes straight into ruku' and stands up again, from the outside it would seem like the person was doing one fluid motion, but it should be distinguished that these are two different acts. So a person should be doing ruku', he should bow, have a moment of assurance, and then stand up. So from the outside it looks like he was doing two separate actions. And then it also suffices that the bowing is happening intentionally. So when a person is about to bow, he should be intending to do the bowing, which this will be explained in the next point, inshallah. When the author says, وَأَن لَا يَقْصُدْ بِهِ غَيْرُهُ, which means when a person moves down to the bowing position, his intention should be to bow, not something else. And it should also be sufficed with the original intention of the prayer, because when a person intends to enter prayer, they intend to do all the actions of the prayer. But if you intend to be in that position for a different reason, then it doesn't suffice. That's why the author next says, فَلَوْ هَوَى لِلتَّلَاوَةِ فَجَعَلَهُ رُكُوعًا لَمْ يَكْفِهِ, which means, so if he moves down with the intention to perform the prostration of recitation, then instead he makes this as his bowing, it does not suffice. So as we probably mentioned before, there are some verses in the Quran that if someone recites while they are during their prayer, then in its sunnah to prostrate. And as we know, as a person prostrates or does sujood, they go from a standing position to a prostrating position. And halfway is the ruku' position. So they said if someone is standing straight and while they're reciting the Quran, he intends to go for the prostration of the recitation, and then halfway, once he gets to the ruku' position, he changes his mind and says, you know what, I'll just make this my ruku'. It doesn't count. So if he intentionally gets in the bowing position while he's going for prostration and changes his mind, then that does not suffice, which means that he has to go back to the standing position that he was in prayer, and then he has to go down for bowing with the intention of bowing. He cannot have another intention going along with it. And then if one, let's say if someone prostrates, someone was praying a regular prayer, then while they were prostrating or in sujood, they start having doubt. Did I do ruku' or no? Then what they need to do is from the prostration position, they have to stand all the way straight, then they go back to the ruku', which means that every time you do ruku', the action before it must be correct. So the correct action before ruku' is i'tidal. So if you think that you forgot your ruku' at any point in prayer, if you're prostrating, for example, you have to get back all the way up straight to i'tidal and then do ruku', and then continue on with your prayer. So it does not suffice just to get up from prostration to ruku'ah, and then said, you know what, I just did my ruku'ah, now let's keep going. That is not allowed. You have to go back to i'tidal completely, then do your bowing. Next point, the next integral, author says, السادس الاعتدال وهو أن يعود إلى ما كان عليه قبله وشرطه الطمأنينة. In sixth, اعتدال, which is to stand straight. That is to go back to what he was upon in the standing position before prostration. And it is a condition to have a momentary pause. So the i'tidal is after ruku' when you go back to standing straight. Say sami'a Allahu liman hamida. So for the i'tidal to happen, what before it must be correct. So as a general rule in a prayer, for every integral to be correct, all the integrals before it must be correct. So if someone did ruku' without doing the Fatiha, then the ruku' is not correct. If someone did i'tidal without a proper ruku', then the i'tidal is incorrect. And you'll see this oftentimes mentioned in detailed books of fiqh. So, and the position of the i'tidal changes from a person to person. So for a person who's praying while they're standing, if they were in ruku' in the bowing, i'tidal for them is to stand straight. And if someone was praying while sitting down, their i'tidal is to go back to sitting down straight. So whatever the position the person was praying in, for them i'tidal is that position. So if you're standing, you go back to standing straight. If you're praying sitting down, then it's going back to sitting in the position that you were in before you're bowing. So like we mentioned, i'tidal changes how a person prays. So generally, it's the position you go back to before you're bowing. It says, وَأَنْ لَا يَقْصُدْ بِهِ غَيْرُهُ فَلَوْ رَفَعَ رَأْسُهُ فَزَعًا مِنْ شَيْءٍ لَمْ يَكْفِي. Which means, and he must not intend to do it for any other reason. So if one were to lift his head due to being startled, then it does not suffice. So as we mentioned before, every action in the prayer must be intended for itself, not for any other reason. So what the author is saying here, if one was to do i'tidal, meaning they were in ruku', they were bowing, then they're going for i'tidal to stand straight, the action of standing straight must be done with the intention of doing i'tidal of prayer. So if someone was prostrate, if someone was bowing doing ruku' and something happens that startles them or scares them, maybe they see a poisonous animal of some sort and they get shocked or scared and they stand up straight and they say, oh, okay, since I'm standing up straight, I did the i'tidal. No, this person has to go back to the bowing position, then stand up straight again. So in every action of prayer, the intention of the action must be the action itself for the sake of prayer, not for any other reason. So also says, if we assume if someone was bowing doing the ruku', and in the middle of the ruku', something happens and they fall and they're trying to get back up into the prayer, a person cannot say, since I'm getting up, I'll just go back to i'tidal. No, if you were doing ruku' and something happens and you fall down, you have to go back into the ruku' position and then you stand up straight into i'tidal. Because like we mentioned, every integral that you do, the integral before it must be done correctly. And your previous integral, which was your ruku', your bowing, was disrupted by you falling down. So you have to go back to that proper ruku' and then you stand up straight. And seventh, أستاذ السابع السجود مرتين، وأقله أن يضع بعض بشرة جبهته على مصلاه. So, and seventh, prostrating twice. And its minimum is to place part of the surface of the forehead on the place of prayer. So oftentimes the fuqaha would define prostration sujood as placing a part of the jabha on the place they pray. So jabha is the forehead. So, and the forehead, basically any part of it must touch the ground or the surface that you're praying on for your prostration to be correct. And that is the minimum. But ideally, it should be just more than just a section, most of your forehead if possible. So with the prostration, some other parts of your body need to touch the ground. The most important is your forehead. Your forehead should be exposed and not covered when you prostrate. As far as the rest of your rest of the limbs of sujood, which are the palms, the knees, the bottom of the toes, those parts also, at least a section of them should be touching the surface that you're praying on. And it's also from the Sahih Hadith, which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam defined ruku' as having seven limbs on the ground: the forehead, the two palms, the two knees, and both feet. Those seven limbs should be touching the ground, but the forehead takes the most importance. And next, the author says, وَشَرْطُهُ الطُمْأَنِينَ وَوَضْعُ جُزْءٍ مِنْ رُكْبَتَيْهِ وَجُزْءٍ مِنْ بُطُونِ كَفَّيْهِ وَأَصَابِعْ رِجْلَيْهِ which is what we mentioned a moment ago, and it is a and its conditions, meaning the conditions of prostration, are a momentary pause and placing a part of both of his knees on the floor and part of the inner palms and part of the bottom of the toes of both feet on the floor as well, or on the space that you're praying. So when prostrating, the knees, or at least a part of the knees and a part of the palms and a part of the bottom of the toes should be touching the surface that you're praying on, at least a part of them. That is the minimum requirement, and those parts can be covered, but the forehead must show. And all these parts need to be on the floor during prostration. For they should all be together at the same time on the floor for at least one moment. So if someone goes into prostration and maybe they lift up both of their feet the whole time, then that prostration is not correct. Or maybe they're using on purpose, they're only using one palm on the floor and lifting up their other palm, then that does not suffice. There should be at least one moment in which in which all seven of those parts should be touching the surface that you're praying on. And next, the author says, وَتَثَاقُضُ رَأْسِهِ وَعَدَمَ الْهَوِي لِغَيْرِهِ, which means, and putting the head down, or the forehead down, with slight pressure on the place of prostration, and not going in the prostration except for the prostration itself. So this is one of the important conditions of doing proper prostration. When you put your head on the floor, it must be with a bit of pressure on the floor. And the way they define it is that, such as if a piece of cotton was placed under your forehead while you're prostrating, that cotton would be compressed, because it means that you really are physically putting your head on the ground. So if someone is just hovering their head slightly above the ground, then that prostration is incorrect. So the head must be put down, not exactly by force, but with some slight pressure. And also, as with all previous integrals, the intention of going down for prostration must happen for that reason itself, not for any other reason. So, which is what the author describes in the next point by saying, فلو سقط على وجهه وجب العود إلى الاعتدال. So if one falls on his face into the position of prostration, then it is obligatory for him to go back to i'tidal, standing position, and then prostrate correctly, which is what we mentioned before with things like ruku' wal i'tidal. They always mention this, وعدم الهوي لغيره. So if someone is standing in the i'tidal position, and for some reason they happen to fall or slip and they end up in the prostration position, a person cannot say, well, that suffices, I'm in the prostration or position already. That would be incorrect. They would have to go back to the standing position, and then they voluntarily do the actions of prostration and go into prostration position. And the author says, so right now the author is talking about the conditions of prostration. And it says, وَإِرْتِفَاعِ أَسْفَلِهِ عَلَىٰ أَعَالِيهِ وَعَدَمَ السُّجُودُ عَلَىٰ شَيْءٍ يَتَحَرَّكْ بِحَرَكَتِهِ إِلَّا أَنْ يَكُونَ فِي يَدْهِ. And one of the most important conditions of prostration is this, where the author says, and to lift one's lower half at a higher level than his upper half, and it is not allowed to prostrate on something which moves together with one's movement, except if it is in his hand. So for the first part, وَإِرْتِفَاعَ أَسَافِلِهِ عَلَىٰ أَعَالِيهِ. So this is the part where the condition of your lower body must be higher than your upper body. So usually what they mean by the lower body is the hip area and what's around it, such as the buttocks and your midsection in general should be higher than your upper body. And your upper body here, they define it as your shoulders, mankib, and your head, ar-ras. So when someone is in the ruku' position, their lower body should be higher, not the feet per se, but all they're referring to is your hip area should be higher than your head and your shoulders. Your head and your shoulders should be down. So if someone is praying at an uneven ground, and he finds that when he's praying, his head and shoulders are at a higher level than his lower body, then that is not a prostration and it is incorrect. So if someone finds that for some reason they're unable to get in that position, maybe the place that they're in is uneven, or maybe for some reason they can't be in that position. So if someone prostrates and the only thing they can, and the only position they can get into, they find that their upper half, meaning their shoulders and head, is higher than their hip area, then this person prays in that position and they have to make it up. They have to make up that prayer later, because they were not able to complete one of the integrals of prayer correctly. And this also goes for someone who's praying while sitting down or laying down. If for some reason at that moment they can't complete this proper this integral properly, then they have to make up the prayer later. And then the second half of this condition, in which the author says, وَعَدَمِ السُّجُودُ عَلَىٰ شَيْءٍ يَتَحَرَّكْ بِحَرَكَتِهِ إِلَّا أَنْ يَكُونَ فِي يَدِهِ. So when someone prays, they should be praying on a surface that is stationary, not on something that is moving. So for example, imagine if someone is praying and they have a huge scarf on their shoulder or a huge shawl. By them putting that shawl on their body, it is technically a part of them during prayer. So if every time as someone prostrates, puts the bottom part of the shawl in front of them to prostrate on, then they stand up, then we'll say that prostration is incorrect because they are praying on something that is moving. So anything that is part of you, something that you're wearing, you cannot prostrate on.
because it is an object that is moving. So if someone, however, if you can detach the item from you and lay it on the ground, then you can pray on it. We see this in some masajid or in some cultures in the world where most men wear shawls. Sometimes you see them when they're about to prostrate, they move the shawl and they lay it on the ground before them, then they pray on top of it. But they leave the shawl on the ground. They don't wear it. When that happens, then that is correct. Then the last part where it says, إلا أن يكون في يده, except if something that's in his hand. So this is given exception to if we say someone is praying while they're holding a towel or a tissue of some sort in their hand during a prayer. And every time they're about to prostrate, they put this towel on the floor. They prostrate on it. Then as they get up, they pick it up. They pick up that towel again. So at that moment where they're doing the prostration, it is detached from them. That is allowed because at that moment, it's not a part of them. But when they get up, they move it. It is allowed, but it is makruh. It is disliked. So ideally, when a person prays, the surface that they're praying on should be something completely stationary, something that doesn't move around. So if the beginning of prayer, they put something down once and they leave it there, then that is okay. But it cannot be something that every time they get up, it comes along with them. But if that item detaches when they put it down, then the prayer is correct, but it is disliked. And the last point we'll mention about the prostration. فَلَوْ عَصَبَ جَمِيعَ جَبْهَتِهِ لِجِرَاحَةٍ وَخَافَ مِنْ نَزْعِ الْعِصَابَةِ سَجَدَ عَلَيْهِ وَلَا قَضَى. So this is for a person who's excused. If we assume someone has some kind of disease or an injury on their forehead and they have to wear some kind of bandage. So in this talks about that scenario. So the author says, so if the whole of one's forehead is covered in a bandage due to an injury and he is afraid of removing it, then he may prostrate on the bandage that is covering his head, and he does not have to make up his prayer. So this is an example of someone who's excused from being unable to fulfill one of the conditions properly due to an excuse that's outside of his control. So this includes if someone says that removing the bandage will probably make him bleed more, or removing the bandage will cause a lot of difficulty in the process, or someone that's afraid if they remove the bandage, putting it back on will also be very, very difficult, or will cause too much burden. So for this kind of person, they are allowed to keep the bandage on. So this kind of person, he will just pray paranormal, and when he does sujood, even though all of his forehead is covered, he will just prostrate. He will just prostrate on it, and he does not have to make up his prayer. Yeah. So just to sum up, the three intervals we talked about: ruku', i'tidal, and sujood, which are bowing, standing straight, and prostration. So each one of those intervals has their own conditions. So quickly, we'll just we'll summarize them. So in ruku', which is bowing, the conditions are أن يصح ما قبله من الأركان, that all the intervals before it were correct, وأن لا يقصد به غيره, which means when he gets in that position that he only intends to do the bowing of the prayer. أن يطمئن فيه, that's the third condition. He should have a momentary pause of assurance. The fourth, أن تكون الطمأنينة فيه يقينا, that he must be absolutely sure that he had a momentary pause of assurance. If he doesn't, then that bowing is incorrect. And fifth, أن ينحني بحيث تنال راحته ركبتيه, that he should bend down to the point that his palms reach his knees. And the sixth, أن يكون بغير انخناس, that the bowing happens without being in the position of inchinas, which is almost like a squatting position that we mentioned before. Then the following integral, al-i'tidal, standing up straight. That one has six conditions as well. First, an yasaha ma qablahu, that everything before it was correct. Second, an la yaqsud bihi ghayru, that he doesn't intend anything else with that movement. The third, أن يطمئن فيه, for him to have a momentary pause. Fourth, أن تكون الطمأنينة فيه يقينا, that momentary pause is done with he's sure about it, that he has no doubt in it, otherwise he will have to redo the action. Fifth, أن ينصب في قار ظهره, that he stands up straight, the same way he was standing up in the beginning of a prayer. The sixth, أن لا يطوله زيادة على الذكر المشروع فيه. So in اعتدال, there's a ذكر that someone reads, which we'll talk about in the future. So the position of اعتدال should be no longer than it takes to recite that dua. And the seventh, integral that we talked about, as-sujud, the prostration, and its conditions are basically repetitive for most of the actions. So أن يصح ما قبله, that what was before is correct, and لا يقصد به غيره, that he intends nothing else beside it. The third and the fourth, أن يطمئن فيه وأن تكون الطمأنينة يقينا, that he is absolutely sure that he has a momentary pause. And he is sure about his momentary pause. The fifth, أن يسجد على سبعة أعضاء, that he prostrates on the seven limbs, which were the forehead, the palms, the knees, and the feet. Sixth, أن تكون جبهته مكشوفة, that the forehead, or at least a part of the forehead, is exposed. Seventh, أن لا يسجد على شيء يتحرك بحركته, that he does not bow, sorry, that he does not prostrate with something that moves with his movement. Eighth, ارتفاع أسافره على أعاليه, that his midsection is raised higher above his upper section. So his upper section, as we said, is classified as the head and the shoulders, and the midsection is classified as the hip area. Ninth, التحامل برأسه, that when he prostrates, he puts slight pressure down with his head, such that it would compress a small piece of cotton. نسأل الله أن يشفعنا جميعا. الحمد لله رب العالمين.